Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Gani Jivier. I'm a Traffic21 Human and Transportation Fellow, and we're really glad to see you here. We're actually so excited to have Paul Mackie from Mobility Lab that we closed off Margaret Morrison, and we brought in a whole bunch of security. we are really excited to have Paul up here today. So, Paul is the communications director for Mobility Lab, and he's been in that role since 2012. He specializes in reporting and writing, editing, helping journalists, and speaking about how places can become vibrant through public transportation initiatives. Mobility Lab has been really effective in reducing the number of single occupancy vehicles traveling in the area that they serve, which is amazing. We're really glad to have you here. We need to hear more about that here in Pittsburgh. He was the Climate Change Communications Director at the Nature Conservancy, Director of Media Relations at the World Resources Institute. He's also been a daily newspaper journalist in his past and freelance for big names such as the Chicago Tribune and National Geographic. He's been largely quoted on transportation issues, including by USA Today and NPR, Washington Post. So we're really glad to have Paul here today. But before he begins, I just want to make one additional plug, which is for Transportation Camp. So Transportation Camp is coming up here in November. It's going to be Pittsburgh's very first Transportation Camp. That's an unconference. And an unconference means that the sessions are determined by the people who attend, right? So everything that we talk about at Transportation Camp will be determined by the folks who show up at the events. We really hope that you'll join. To get information about registration, you can go to transportationcamp.org, and we're one of the first events listed for the very next camp that's coming up. So I hope that you will go on and register for Transportation Camp. It's just $15 for students, and breakfast and lunch are included. But without further ado, I'm going to have Paul come up and tell us a little bit more about his role at Mobility Lab.
Thank you, Gani and Courtney. Thanks so much for having me come and speak to you all. This is really cool. I love Pittsburgh, even though I've barely been here in my life. I think once or twice. I think I've only been here once before for like a week or two. And I love it because I grew up in St. Louis, and we had the St. Louis Cardinals football team back when I was a little kid growing up. And it was either choose them or choose somebody that was scary and awesome and was winning Super Bowls. So I went with the winner, and the people like Jack Lambert, you know, didn't have teeth in their mouth. And that was like, to me, that was, and black scary uniforms, to me, that was the essence of what football should be like. So so I love Pittsburgh for that reason. I'm actually going to my first game on Sunday at the stadium, first game in Pittsburgh ever. Are there any Steelers fans here? Okay, two Steelers fans. So let's get to transportation then and stop talking football. That's a very bad way to start. And thank you for the plug on Transportation Camp. Mobility Lab is heavily involved in Transportation Camp, and I don't sugarcoat many things or, you know, talk in much sales speak or anything, but Transportation Camp is awesome because of all the things I'm going to talk about here today, that is one of the things that we think at Mobility Lab that can really, people can come together, no matter if they're tinkerers or do-it-yourselfers or engineers or aspiring engineers or whatever it is, and come together. Usually there are, you know, people from within the government and thought leaders and policy leaders and sometimes business leaders at these transportation camps, and it's a really great way to bridge ideas that are outside of the box in a way from the way that people in power sometimes have been thinking about them for a very long time. So it's a really great way to influence. So we love Transportation Camp. And so I'm talking about smart transportation, small changes for big impact. Transportation Camp obviously being one of those. And this is a really exciting time too for it, because things like the USDOT Smart City Challenge are getting cities to really think in this competitive mindset that they really haven't been in the transportation space for for a long time. It's been, you know, get in your car and go, and that's how we're going to do it. That's how we've always done it. So this is a really exciting time for you all to be in this space. So I hope you'll like some of the things I'm going to show you here. Why Mobility Lab? Just a little bit. This is a picture of our homepage recently. And Arlington, Virginia is right across the river, right across the Potomac River from Washington, D.C. About 40, 50 years ago, it used to just be a concrete jungle of parking lots and industrial buildings, and it was a pass-through for people to get either in or out of Washington, D.C. It's still that now, but there's very little traffic, and there's very little traffic jams, and it's really strange and kind of fascinating that this spot that you would think would be so close to the center of where everybody's going to and from would just be packed with cars. But Arlington's leaders long ago, and they've had, the thing is, Arlington has movers and shakers, I'll refer to a lot as thought leaders and policy leaders and business leaders. They had the foresight to say, okay, let's build the metro underneath and we'll form corridors of businesses, walkable, vibrant communities. They thought of this way back when, 40 years ago. And now there's two really beautiful corridors in Arlington that are packed with businesses, packed with residences, multi-use, and you just don't see that many cars going down the roads. And bike lanes, and it's pretty phenomenal. So it's a transit-oriented development. Arlington is one of the leaders in the country on transit-oriented development. There's this other arm of it called transportation demand management, which is really what Mobility Lab focuses on, and that's a fancy, wonky term for transportation behavior. Why is it that we do the things that we do when we're getting around and traveling? So we really are looking at sort of the psychology and the sociology of our travel behavior. And so we do all this research. We've done all this research for about 15 years. About 5 years ago, Mobility Lab was created, and along with that, they hired me to come in and tell the stories of, find the stories within that research and start amplifying them as both a way to continue to make Arlington a leader, but to show people how it was done and to also bring back ideas, to start to get feedback from people, how's it being done in other places around the country? And apply that and make ourselves better in Arlington as well. So we do research, we tell stories, we have citizen engagement, which I'll tell you a little bit more about later, and innovation and even advocacy. Ray LaHood, former USDOT secretary, came to one of our events recently and spoke. And basically his big takeaway is there should be mobility labs everywhere. So we take that to heart, and we do hope that there will be mobility labs everywhere in every city, because we think that, you'll see why we think that, but transportation story is just not told enough. And I'll say that again and again, public transportation. So step back a little bit. We're obviously a car country, and a lot of us, I talk to a lot of transportation groups and public transportation groups, and you know, we all sort of get in this bubble of thinking, you know, we all take transit, we all take bikes, we all walk, we all telework, we all do the things that will spread the love out a little bit, and so it's not just clogged highways everywhere and roadways. But the fact is, we are fighting a very big uphill battle. Cars are still cool. 85% of the people in the country drive alone to work. And the way that they're getting better and better in many ways, even young people, even though we hear about people getting their driver's licenses later and later, even younger people are going to be attached to cars and car culture. So I think this presents a big opportunity for people in the public transportation space. Not only is it a huge challenge, because we have a huge job to do to spread that love out of the way we move around, but you know, one of the opportunities that we have is people love their cars, but most people hate driving. So if we focus in on some of that hating driving part, I think we can go far. And I think that's a good segue to a little short, I think it's about a 4-minute video. Mobility Lab is in the business of, one of the ways we tell stories is through videos. And we got to interview some really smart people, and I think it's a good segue here on sort of the future of driving.
The technology around the world that has kind of taken off is figuring out how to tap into an inefficiency or an information gap. And for some reason, transportation, we didn't think these existed even though they were pervasive.
Every day, we ignore a surplus of transportation capacity, especially when 85% of cars have only one person in them. Nearly every car on the road is full of empty seats ready for passengers.
So for decades, people have tried to achieve the vision of filling the empty seats in cars. It was tried during the 1940s, during World War II, during the 1970s, during the fuel crisis. And yet they've never been able to get the level of mainstream adoption with carpooling that you really need to make a difference.
That a lot of times was being driven by information gaps, not by unwillingness of people to travel with other people. The term in aviation is the load factor. So I think if you can start to really expand the load factor of the single occupant vehicle and start to have one, two, three more people in the car, it's a classic opportunity to absorb that excess supply with technology.
Hitchhiking used to be a way to fill up seats in cars.
You didn't see, or at least you didn't hear about heinous things happen to people as much. So people would hitchhike. Now, recently, with the social media aspect of the network companies, you feel like you're not just out there on your own.
To enable true carpooling, it needs to be easy for drivers and passengers to find each other.
And you need that perfect snowflake of a match of someone who's starting at the same place and going to the same place, and the sheer probability that there is a match like that in a 1 minute interval when you request a ride is really, really low if you only have a few people in the system.
We are getting increasingly close to having robust data sets about where, when, and how people are traveling. People's willingness to participate in things like Waze and a lot of these other technologies, these are providing information and data sets that, you know, like 5 years ago, governments would have dreamed to be able to get access to.
So driving is changing very rapidly right now. We're in an exciting time where a lot of new technologies are coming out, and we're right on the cusp of those technologies beginning to converge. Every car pretty much now is getting an internet connection and able to communicate. We have, you know, Tesla proving that electric cars can be cool and fun and high performance. We have Google and many other companies now developing autonomous cars to drive themselves. Then we have Uber and other sharing companies demonstrating that you can actually share rides. In the future, those will combine. So an electric, shared, autonomous car. I call it ACES, which is an automated car that drives electrically, that multiple people can share, that can pick up and drop off passengers along the way. So think of it as a new mode that really sits between private car ownership and public transit.
If new technologies can take even a few cars off the road, we may see dramatic reductions in congestion.
We have things set up now like Soviet bread lines. Everyone's crowding into the highway because it's free. And it doesn't take that much change to increase traffic flow at peak times. If you just have a small percentage of people choosing, you know, I'll go a little later, I'll go a little earlier, take mass transit, a bike, all of a sudden you free up the conditions on the roadway pretty dramatically.
Ultimately, the success of transportation advancement will be judged on its ability to produce efficient behavior.
You have to reduce the number of people driving alone. The alternative is to widen the roads. Within a few years, most roads that are widened because of induced demand fill up, and you have the same problem over and over again, unless you make some behavior modification.
Actually, there's lots of applications in the market today that already are excellent at optimizing capacity. The challenge is not the technology, the challenge is human behavior. I think the future holds a lot of change that we can't necessarily see today, with generation changes, millennials wanting to live in cities and be more car-free. Ultimately, I think we'll have a much lower car ownership in America 10, 20 years from now.
So, I maybe didn't give you enough information about what Mobility Lab is. It's embedded in Arlington County. So it is a government entity. Mobility Lab is actually sort of like a contractor to Arlington County. So we get a little bit of funding from USDOT and Virginia DOT as well. But it's something that really doesn't exist. Traffic 21 is pretty close, although you all really focus on transit tech, whereas our sort of niche is transportation behavior. So it doesn't really exist there. I don't know of any other places in the US or governments or public entities that have something that focuses on why are we moving the way we do and try to educate people about perhaps moving in better ways. It's a little convoluted, but it is what it is. So let's see, where were we? I was at a driverless vehicle conference in Detroit not too long ago, and it was automaker. It was interesting because automakers, all they ever talk about now is we're not auto companies, we're mobility companies. They've seen the writing on the wall. In other words, they got to branch out and not just focus on cars. But at the same time, and the tech companies who were there, all they said again and again and again is this is going to happen. Driverless vehicles are going to happen, and perhaps it is. But right now, you know, the majority of Americans don't want driverless vehicles yet. So it's going to be interesting to see how auto and tech companies continue to ram it down our throats until they're actually on the road. I know that's a little bit risky of a thing to say here in Pittsburgh because you all have embraced it so wholeheartedly, and that's great. I mean, we need places that are going to embrace it because I think there are a lot of good things. Like Stephen Heck in the video said, you know, if it's autonomous and electric and shared, especially the shared part Mobility Lab is really interested in, then we won't necessarily make our traffic worse. If it's not shared and everybody wants to own their own, you know, autonomous vehicles, we're in big, big trouble in this country. So, you know, driving is going to compete with your living room. As I said before, you know, the broadband in cars now is in many cases more than what you have barreling down the interstate. It's more than what you have back home in your living room. So that's hard for transit to compete with. The Super Bowl, I often talk about the Super Bowl advertisements. There's about 20 for cars usually. There aren't any for transit, and there are a lot of reasons for that. You know, public entities don't necessarily have money to have commercials for transit, especially during the Super Bowl. But what the car companies have done is they usually show you a car going down a beautiful West Coast highway with no traffic and the top down, and it's the most glorious thing, when we all know 90% of the time in your car is nothing like that. I'm just saying that transit maybe could take some pointers. You know, and I'll get into that a little bit more. I'm not saying to lie, I'm just saying, like the car companies have done, I'm just saying there are smarter ways of doing things and advertising in particular. Transit is terrible at fixing and promoting itself. There are a lot of examples, but this one, if you see something, say something, is probably the most famous. It started in New York City. The idea was gestated the night after, I believe, 9/11. Happened back in 2001, and there was a time and place for it, and it really worked. It actually worked really well. If you see something, say something, baggage reports, you know, suspicious baggage reports went way, way up for a couple of years after 9/11. But now you see that everywhere, and there is an element that safety needs to be talked about. Absolutely no doubt about that. But when this is almost all you see all the time at transit, you look at that, I would look at that if I were, say, an alien coming down from outer space and I came in, I saw, oh, see something, say something, okay, nobody's riding this, it's dirty, it's got a bag that has clearly been left by a terrorist or somebody of the like, I'm going to go, where's a rental car place? You know, I'm going to get out of here and go take something that's a little more pleasing to the eye. Oops. TMA's in the news. TMAs are Transportation Management Associations. This is actually the reason I'm here in Pittsburgh, is I'm speaking to three different Transportation Management Associations tomorrow that are from the Oakland area, Oakland County area. And these are entities that work with businesses. TMAs are usually private entities that work with businesses to make sure that they know about the federal transit benefit that's in place that you can use instead of a parking benefit when you go to work. Or, you know, just to know about all kinds of the good things about transportation options. They help businesses with that. So TMAs in the news, a recent search, Google search for the kind of news that's being covered about TMAs is kind of interesting because buses remain empty along city's worst traffic spots. That's a problem. In most places you go, buses are indeed empty, and they have an image problem. People, for whatever reasons, don't gravitate to buses. It's a shame. I just rode the 28X in from the airport just a little while ago, and it was glorious. I sat there and I relaxed and I, you know, eased my mind, and it probably took the same amount of time as a car would. But there's one that comes, I'll get into that later. I see you shaking your head. I'll get into this in a little bit later too. But anyway, nobody knows about it for one. And there's one every 30 minutes. And it was full by, you know, a couple stops in, but not everybody was sitting. There was nobody standing. So the demand is not there. But it was pretty enjoyably fast, I thought. Palo Alto banks on new nonprofit to reduce downtown traffic. OK, so this is cool. Palo Alto starts a TMA, essentially. City Council gives them $100,000. the heck are you going to do with $100,000? So that's pretty typical. National Bike Month is in full gear. Okay, great, but why do we only have one bike month? I mean, why isn't it bike always? That's sort of a mindset I think that we're in, and the bike community does a lot of great stuff, don't get me wrong. But just having a bike month is, I don't think, is enough. This is Annapolis, Maryland, is stuck with Forest Drive congestion. I think what that story was all about is basically they were looking for a public-private partnership to deal with their congestion. And I thought that was a really uplifting thing. I think it's, you know, when you have $100,000, you probably need to find some partners to do something a little better with. These TMAs and these TDM agencies, of which Mobility Lab is a part, Transportation Demand Management, essentially need better numbers to sell themselves. That's a lot of the reason why we don't see as many stories as we do, because the numbers just aren't there. I don't even know, I'm not sure North Bay Shore, I'm not sure what community this actually is, but they had set a cap of, you can't get very good numbers on what kind of traffic reduction, drive alone car traffic you want to achieve. You know, so you don't have actual numbers. This is a pretty good way to go about it. 45%, they want to cap solo driving at 45%. So they want 55% to not be solo driving. That's a pretty ambitious goal in most communities, very ambitious goal in most communities. So that's good. Set a goal for yourself if it's too hard. In Arlington, we've got all these services that I mentioned before. We're in the same offices with Capital Bike Share and GoDCGo and the DC Circulator Bus, and Employer Services is a thing called Arlington Transportation Partners. We have, Mobility Lab has run the numbers, and through it we find that this work of these different agencies, these different organizations in Arlington actually take 41,000 cars, drive alone car trips, off the road each workday. So that's kind of hard to put in your head, what does that actually mean, but it is a lot of traffic. It's a lot of traffic, and it's one of the reasons why Arlington streets are not as crowded as a lot of the surrounding jurisdictions throughout Washington, D.C. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation cuts solo driving. They moved locations from one part of downtown Seattle to another part of downtown Seattle. And in that subsequent like 6 years, they started a transportation program in their organization. And they had before had 88% of their people driving alone to work. And it got cut to, oh gosh, I'm blanking. It got cut to, I want to say, around 40% in just a couple years through this transportation program, which is essentially a transportation demand management or a TMA type program. But businesses are very, it's been very difficult. In Arlington alone, we have about 300 businesses that are advised by this Arlington Transportation Partners group. But they're very gun shy. They don't want to tell their stories for whatever, they don't want to give away their trade secrets. So they're not telling their stories of how they're actually helping the society, the community they're in, become better, or why their employees are happier getting to work and being at work.
I was just wondering, like, usually when they build a new high-rise building or building downtown, they have to put in some parking spaces in the garage. Or, yeah. Is there any room to do away with that kind of zoning requirement, you know, to discourage people from driving? And I see Gates Foundation and Microsoft, and I'm thinking, well, when they built their plants, do they reduce the amount of parking spaces to force people to take public transportation because there's not going to be parking places there for them?
Yeah, and I'll get into that just a little. I'll touch on that a little bit later about parking. It's a huge issue. Facebook recently was offering $10,000 to their employees to move closer to work, so that they could, so I think that they could bike and walk and take ways that weren't driving alone, or they could take closer in shuttles. That's a very extreme version of transportation demand management, and not many small businesses or companies can do something like that. But yes, parking is a huge issue. Let's get back to that. And feel free to jump in, anyone, as we go. So we need buy-in from developers and leaders and people. Much like the bus, the 28X here, I was recently giving a talk down in Raleigh to this organization called Innovate Raleigh. And the night I was able to get there the night before, and not only was their bus from the airport also great, nobody knew about it. It was even emptier than Pittsburgh's. Pittsburgh knows about its bus from the airport a lot more than Raleigh does. I'll say that based on my limited experience. But also this Raleigh bus, it was during rush hour that I arrived and it was during rush hour that I left. And it on the interstate, after it gets out of, you know, there's downtown Raleigh and then there's like NC State and then there's the airport. Once it gets past NC State, it all becomes interstate. And these cars were all totally backed up. It was a total quagmire mess. And the buses all jump into the shoulder and they're just flying past everybody. It was amazing and it was great. And that was definitely much faster. I got to the airport before I thought I was gonna get to the airport. And but I was talking to a group of transportation experts. Nobody even knew a long time. There were several people, not nobody. There were several people who said to me afterwards, I've never even heard of there's an airport. There's a bus from airport to downtown. It dropped me off right in front of my hotel and everything. So we have a big problem, perhaps especially within the transportation community, of not knowing what they've got. Not riding. When a politician hasn't ridden the bus before, or hasn't ridden their own subway before, or hasn't tried the bike lanes, that's a huge, huge problem that we all should come together and, you know, do what we can to say, you know, if you're going to be my leader, you got to try these things. This is this route. This is in downtown Raleigh. And I thought it was great that they have this R-line circulator. And this is all of downtown. So basically, you could go down and you could go work downtown. And you could say you work here. You could go for lunch over to totally across town. This is further than it looks. And you could grab lunch with somebody or have a meeting and get back real quick. This is a thing that it takes like 15 minutes maybe to go around the whole thing. And when you whip out your smartphone and turn to this site, it automatically has the two little buses that are always running and they're going like this, like clockwork around. So, you know, I was down here and I was like, oh, there's a bus coming this way. So I just came up to here and waited for a second and it was there. So I was talking, not to pick on anyone, but one of the heads of Wells Fargo, and they've been getting picked on enough as it is lately, but I was talking to her after the presentation, and you know, I said, you've got this blueprint. You've got this beautiful blueprint of this brilliant circulator bus, and nobody was riding that either when I was on it. And you could really you could get by without a car in downtown Raleigh and the surrounding suburbs. It's pretty amazing. And she just stood there and said, nope, no way, no way in hell, mister, is any of this ever going to happen? And so we need to get that kind of thinking out of, you know, our leaders and our movers and shakers, because she clearly had no idea what she was talking about, but she was introducing all the transportation, you know, experts at this Innovate conference. It was quite disgusting. So we need to figure out a way to value our buses in the U.S. And I think we're getting there. We're starting, as people become frustrated and by traffic and, you know, they don't want to deal with the hassles of parking, which, you know, great percentage of traffic in downtowns is people circling looking for parking. These kinds of options become a lot more attractive. So I'm a communications director and a communications and journalism background, so I often focus on what are the messages. You know, we saw earlier the see something, say something. It's a very defensive message. So I always say, you know, let's communicate the things we're doing, because often we do them and then we go back to maybe tell people at the water cooler, but we don't use a megaphone to talk about what we're doing. And most important, do this loudly, do this often, but most importantly, do it in a positive light. I think positive messages can go a long way over time. It won't happen overnight. Little chip away with little positive messages about the good things, about non-driving alone trips, and they'll get out there. You know, why do we talk about if you see something, say something? Why do Washington, D.C. has this campaign of people with their faces covered with tire tracks? And they're pedestrians and bicyclists. And they're basically scare campaigns that D.C. DOT loves. They love it. They won't stop it. It's part of their Vision Zero. It's all great, but it's such overkill to constantly be scaring people. There's even one poster that has, you know, somebody is walking with dark clothes and it says, and it's twilight or something. They said, don't walk with dark clothes out or else you'll get hit by a car. It's like, okay, now you're telling me how to dress. It's reasons why people don't like the government often, these kinds of things. there are all kinds of great messages out there that we're just not talking about loud enough. You know that high-speed rail would be 4 times faster if you took it in cross-country than if it existed in a good way, like other countries. It would be 4 times faster cross-country than driving. That's pretty powerful, and you know we don't say it enough, so maybe that's why we don't do it. I'm not sure. Bike share is the safest mode. Another message. Bike share is the safest mode in the entire country. And I can still say that even after the very first fatality, which I believe was in Chicago a couple months ago, up to that point, there were no fatalities ever on bike share in the country. So you really could say bike share is the safest mode, but we never did. And we should have. We should still. It would be nice to have great infrastructure because that makes our jobs much harder when we're talking about the education and the motivation and the behavioral aspects of getting people to do and try other ways of getting around. So sometimes the infrastructure really doesn't hurt, really doesn't help. But Mobility Lab is not focused on the infrastructure. Mobility Lab is only focused on the, you know, how do we get people to do this stuff at, you know, sort of low cost. And then there's research that comes out, you know, buses are up to 60 times safer than cars. There's recent APTA findings that that transit is 10 times safer than cars. We don't hear about that much. And I guarantee you, you know, if you ever are hit in a car by a bus, you don't want it to be the other way around. It's always, you know, the car always ends up like this. The bus always ends up like this. Buses, you know, are great in that respect. You're not, for the most part, going to die, which we do all the time in cars. That is a good question, and bike deaths by ratio, I think, have been going up in the past couple of years, actually, which, you know, which also has something to do with, you know, there are more of them now, but, you know, I don't know. I don't know the answer to your question. It's a very good question, and it's, you know, we could find it real quick. But there are other messages. You know, if you're going to talk about safety, this is kind of cute. They had, you know, don't chase your Pokemon Go onto the tracks. It's not very smart. So I kind of like messages like that. They're a little less preachy and a little more fun and a little more pop culture-like. So another thing is that, you know, with just very few people who change modes, down to as low as, like, 3 people, I think the statistic is you take 3 people away from driving alone and it improves traffic about 30, per, 3 out of 100, it improves traffic about 30%. So it's not asking a whole lot to get people to shift modes. You would see a lot of improvements as you do these things right away. I already showed this, so this is a little bit of a mistake. So it's 88% to 42% that the Gates Foundation got their drive alone rate of employees down. But as I said, there are many other businesses that are telling this story, that are not telling this story, that I think if they did, it would help move the needle too. So like I said, with Mobility Lab, we don't focus on infrastructure. And often you hear people say, you know, well, there's just, we don't have the money. We don't have the money to do transportation. And it's true, waiting around for big federal or state grants to do massive road building or transit building projects is not the way to go for the most part. But I'm going to continue to talk about little things that you can do for a lot less money that you don't have to be so dependent on others for that money. One of the things that was great was when the Bridge to Nowhere in Alaska happened in 2005, Congress removed the pork barrel funding that allowed money to go to projects like the Bridge to Nowhere, which carried something like 50 people every day. It was a massive cost. Data now should help us make smarter decisions about infrastructure. The thing is with data is that there's so much of it, but we're not doing enough to tell the stories of what's within it. So that's one thing we often talk about at Mobility Lab. How do we pull those stories out and make that data real? So I think that's something Courtney and Traffic21 and others around the country are really thinking about how do we make data really sing a little bit better and work for us a little bit better. So next I'm going to just talk about five areas where we could do these small things and we could make a big difference real quickly. Mobility Lab has this thing called Transportation Techies, and that's what I'm talking about, bringing data. It's a show and tell. Every month we have it. One month it might be about Metro, or one month it might be about bike share. We've even had it at Metro in DC, WMATA headquarters, and we've had it in Baltimore, and we've had it in Portland, Oregon, where leaders are really there and listening to what's being said. But it's a show and tell where Michael Shade, who's our tech guru at Mobility Lab, gets about six or seven or eight people each time who are usually hackers or data geeks, and they get up and they say, show the project that they've been working on, data, and then they say what they think that data is showing them. And that's been really great. This Transportation Techies, it's amazing. We've gone from zero about 3 years ago to pretty close to 2,000 Transportation Techies in DC. And it just showed us that there's a huge community of these geeks out there in DC, and I'm sure they're everywhere. And it's a meetup group, so it's all online on a meetup group. And then the meetings are actually in person every month, somewhere different. And this person was coming up to present and riding a Capital Bike Share bike on the way up. So with that, and we also run Transportation Camp, which I guess the main one is held in Washington, D.C. when the Transportation Research Board comes to town every January. And since about 15, 20 other places around the country and around the world have had transportation camps, Pittsburgh's is coming up soon. That's a great way to bridge, knowledge gaps of people in government and people in businesses and just regular people and students and people like that. So with the website, we started also with, when I came in as communications director, we basically had a website. It was a pretty beautiful website at the time, but we had two or three bloggers who are on staff who had blogged maybe 10 blogs or something. And I said, look, okay, so we've got a website here. Let's make this thing really great. And I was coming from a media background, so of course I said, let's make ourselves the media. Let's be the media. Because there weren't that many, there aren't that many transportation reporters who are covering something besides the traffic beat. Now there are a few more, but usually they're not covering sociological issues. For transportation. So we said, we could own this space. We could do this. And we did. And since then, we've now got about 130 or 40 contributors who contribute to the site. And we do a lot of curating of the news and try to analyze the news about transportation demand and transportation behavior. So we can kind of be the place to go for transportation behavior news. That was our idea. So, find collaborators. They're out there too. All these people just want to come and write for us, and it's amazing. We don't even really push it that much, but constantly we're getting articles in, and video ideas and all kinds of things. And we try to do it as much as we can. Artists, writers, students who just want to build up their portfolio, they're out there, and for some reason they want to talk about transportation. So it's a neat topic for a lot of people. Very passionate topic for a lot of people. So it's helped us tell the story of this transportation demand industry, which really needed a story. And I do think that more people are understanding what this industry is and the importance of educating people about their transportation choices. So I think just having a megaphone and a voice like that and a media website for it is one way to go about it. One thing to do also in storytelling is to educate the media. This person is a reporter in Florida, and she was just sick of seeing all the time, all these bike deaths and pedestrian deaths in South Florida. And so she did a sort of a New York Times, like, you remember after 9/11, they did a feature on each of the people who died on 9/11. So she did a feature on all the people who died getting hit on South Florida's extremely dangerous roadways. And she ended up winning awards for it. And there's now a complete streets program in place that was directly related to this happening, to this story series. So, a lot of time the media just frames it in really bad ways. They frame them as accidents. They frame them as victim blaming. They frame them as, you know, the parents let the kid run out in the street and got hit by a car. And that actually got hit by a driver would have been one way to put it. And it was a crash. It wasn't an accident. So there are all kinds of different ways that the media needs to be educated about how we talk about places and streets and who owns those places and how should we talk about them a little better so that we can see change. And newsletters are great, but they're not. Because I recently heard something, it was from Content Marketing Institute. They had done a survey of hundreds of newsletter people who publish newsletters for their organizations or whatever. And they found that basically 90% of them sucked really bad, like really bad. This is just, you know, people are talking in their newsletters about themselves. They're talking about, you know, sales speak. They're trying to sell you something without building some sort of relationship first. And any newsletter or any communications about any of this should always offer, you know, exclusives to people. That there should be exclusives in that newsletter that you can't find anywhere else. There should be, you know, a consistent format so people know how to read it. And there should be insights that you can't necessarily get everywhere else. But a newsletter is a really cheap, effective way, if you can do it right, to influence your audiences. Okay, a second easy way to do a bunch of stuff on the cheap is to be creative. Sell the lifestyle. This is the Red Bulletin magazine. Many of you have probably heard of it. But many more of you have probably heard of Red Bull, which is the energy drink. They have this magazine that doesn't talk anything about really Red Bull. It might, page 200 might have a little tiny plug for the energy beverage, but for the most part, it's selling you the lifestyle. And that's what public transportation advocates and people in the space and planners and everybody in the space needs to sell a lifestyle. We've got a lifestyle that's in many ways a lot better than the car lifestyle that we've built up and the culture that we've built up in this country. The Red Bulletin has more subscribers than Sports Illustrated. So people are buying into this lifestyle. And even if just a fraction of those people who subscribe to it end up buying Red Bull someday at the store, then this has succeeded in their minds. And in Red Bull media companies' minds, this has really succeeded. Because it's built trust. We got to get the basics of payment right. And Wi-Fi on buses and in public spaces is really good. There's a lot more public kiosks, Wi-Fi kiosks going up in cities, which is kind of interesting. This is a group. This sign right here is by Transit Screen. And they were incubated at Mobility Lab. So we also let people come in sometimes and work on their ideas and refine their ideas, their technology ideas. They've gone to market, and they want to have information. You know, they've now got information in bars in DC, and their goal by the end of the year is to be in 40 countries by the end of 2016. So they're really moving along great on it, and they're, you know, they quit their jobs. Those guys quit their jobs, and they're now focused on Transit Screen. The idea is just making it easier for people to perhaps take transit. Because it'll show you, you know, it's place-based. It'll show you there are 6 bike share bikes nearby. There's, you know, 3 minutes to the next train, 2 minutes to the next bus. And so they're putting them in office buildings and bars. And this one's on a sidewalk in a business district. Another thing that I really love is this IOB, which stands for In Our Backyards, I think. They're doing really great work. They're based out of New York, and they just opened in DC too. But they give grants. They give small grants to neighborhoods. It's like a Kickstarter campaign almost, to do interesting things with their neighborhoods. And a lot of them are transportation grants. A lot of them are other things, placemaking grants. One of their videos showed this. I love this, showing a bus stop. What if you went to a bus stop and there was maybe far-fetched to have a harpsichord player, but you know, serving coffee and books and comfortable chairs instead of sitting on cement or standing on cement with, you know, 50 mile an hour cars whizzing past, you know, a little sandbox maybe for your kid to play in. So I think things like that, you know, neighborhoods can really get together on that and move quickly and make these places more of a destination rather than a, oh, I would never go there kind of place. And this is somebody just in Washington, D.C. redesigned the travel cards for Metrobus. You know, you that you pick up for the bus when you're at a bus stop and you try to read where it goes to. Just made a ton of improvements, and the city has not implemented it yet, but it's a heck of a lot better and more understandable than the way that information is transmitted by the city right now. Enough is enough. Miami has just introduced a trust fund where they basically have dedicated fundings coming each year from the general fund, and this is a bigger deal, but they have dedicated funding coming from several funds that will help them make transportation improvements as they go. So that's, but it's being creative, saying, you know, look, we're not going to wait around for alternate funding. Now back to your parking point, this is really important, and this message is not heard nearly enough, that parking hurts your bottom line. You know, we go and we see this massive concrete jungle, and just think of what could be there. Think of all the things that could be there. In Arlington and internationally all over, there's this thing called Parking Day, where parking spots get turned into other uses. You know, one organization will say, okay, we're gonna take these two parking spots for the day. You have to file with the city and everything, and turn it into, you know, throwing horseshoes or having coffee or just having couches for people to sit and talk at. There are so many better ways that parking can be used. And some of those ways are, you know, Chicago lowered parking minimums, which is sort of getting to your point, you know. Now, often there are parking minimums which require developers to put in a set amount of spots, no matter if you are right next to the train station and you 90% of your residents don't have cars. So then you end up having all these empty spots, which could be, you know, one spot could be almost a full efficiency in New York City. So using our space pretty poorly with parking. And Chicago is one of the many cities that are starting to get it with parking minimums. Portland actually stopped adding downtown parking in the 70s. And if you've been to Portland or walked around Portland, it's great. You can tell. It's clear why business is booming there. San Francisco and DC pricing parking by demand. San Francisco sort of pioneered this with SF Park. But basically, it's metered parking, and it, depending on the demand for the spot in any given time, the price changes. So, you know, it gets people to move further out from the high. If you don't want to pay as much, you have to park a couple blocks away, usually from the highest demand spots. And just working, you know, in Arlington, we really work with employers and developers on that issue of parking. How are we going to make it better so that, you know, if you're whizzing past a business in a car, and businesses don't get this yet for the most part, if you're whizzing past in a car, you're actually less, research shows you're less liable to stop than if you're walking or biking past their store, not their car. And businesses don't get that bike parking, you know, get rid of a parking spot and add, you know, what would be 8 spots of bike parking. Don't get that is would actually be helpful to their business. So those are messages that can really be amplified. A big thing now is the first mile, last mile area. The National League of Cities came out with a report recently on, right here, only 3% of city transit plans even consider Uber and Lyft, which just goes to show how far cities are behind and how much they have to catch up. You know, if you're not even considering Uber and Lyft as part of the roadmap, the network of how people are moving around, then I don't know what to tell you. But now USDOT had this smart city challenge that's wrapped up earlier this year. Columbus, Ohio won. It was $50 million, and the city is also pitching in a lot of money on top of that in Columbus, Ohio. So everybody will be watching Columbus, Ohio to see what they do to become the smart city. But there were also about 77 other cities who applied for this competition. And just to have cities competing like that for transportation innovation is really exciting. It's not something that we've necessarily had before, and we think that there needs to be a lot more of that. There are pilot apps, and that first mile, last mile thing is sort of pilot apps for Uber to transit. That's the first mile. Say you live a mile away from transit, you need some way to get there perhaps. They're trying to make it more less expensive in LA, Denver, Portland, Kansas City, Memphis, and Raleigh-Durham to get to use transit with Uber. So that's hopeful. We're concerned that Uber is adding more car trips to the road and that they're circling looking for people. Some of that and some of the environmental ramifications are still unknown right now. But there are other hopeful things like Waze carpool. You know how everybody is using Waze when you drive around to try to beat the traffic, to try to not get stuck in traffic. There's the Waze effect. People are cutting through neighborhoods that maybe they shouldn't be cutting through, but Waze is telling them to do it, and you're avoiding traffic. If Waze actually did it kind of more for good, which would be doing the carpool model of somewhere along your Waze route, other people could get in the car and join you, that would be something that would be, it would be like a roving transit, you know, on-demand transit, which would be great in people's own personal cars too. Perhaps we're not ready for that, but you know, perhaps we didn't think, as Americans, perhaps we didn't think we were ready for Uber and Lyft, and it sure seems like we are. A small percentage of Americans only still use Uber and Lyft, but it's growing, and especially growing in cities. 900 bike share systems throughout the world, that is a really relatively low cost option for cities to make connections between transit, to make connections between, you know, job centers, affordable housing areas, whatever you want to do it. And electric bicycles, I love this stat that I read in the Wall Street Journal recently, that said 60% of the batteries in China now are being made for electric bicycles, which, you know, as things like SafeTrack in Washington, D.C., which is a year-long project that has really messed up the transit, the subway system in D.C., or, you know, the bridge that's going to go from Brooklyn to New York, when that, is it a bridge or is it maybe it's a transit line? I think it's a bridge, maybe, and a transit line, but that's going to be shut down for 18 months or a year in New York City. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Those electric bikes could be a real option. And that stat got me thinking, you know, China has got to be saying, you know, it's not just China. We're not just going to sell these batteries for electric bicycles to Chinese people. We're going to try to sell them to people in the U.S. and people in Europe, where electric bikes have already caught on in a big way. And last, I think what's really fitting in Pittsburgh, there's so many schools, is focus these options on schools. And we need people like you to really do this, because the problem with schools is planners often don't think about transportation options for schools. And a huge, huge percentage of places, you know, a huge percentage of kids and teachers get to school in cars, not single occupancy vehicles, but cars. Some go in buses, so that's good. But especially with teachers, Arlington is the first place in the country that started a program focusing on teachers and staff at schools to get them to try to find other ways to go besides always driving alone, which is hard because, you know, often teachers are carrying a lot of stuff with them. But anyway, trying to work on transportation for schools is hard. You know, planners are focused on land use issues, and they're not necessarily thinking about the transportation connections into schools as part of that. And they're often focused on cars and buses as the way into schools. Teachers can't do it because, like I said, they've got other things. You know, they've got a lot on their plates already. And parents won't do it because parents are often, you know, their kids in a school for 2 or 3 years, and then they go to the next school for 2, 3, 4 years. So it's kind of not worth the time to invest to have safe route. Thank God for Safe Routes to Schools, which is a great organization, and they are looking at how can more kids walk and bike like in the old days to school, which would actually be much healthier for them, and they would be happier, and they wouldn't be tired from lack of activity. And so there are all kinds of reasons why kids should bike and walk to school. There's one thing that we've done, and Alexandria, Virginia, did this with us, is this thing called a radius ride. And it's where you get just a group of volunteers and you map out how far people live from the school. And then you are able to figure out what are the best ways that people could actually go, what are the best routes, and then you could create publicity material or whatever it is to get people to do that. Also at Mobility Lab, Arlington Transportation Partners really is taking surveys and setting aggressive targets with the schools there in Arlington to try to lower the amount of kids who are not biking and walking. Yeah. And the good thing about tech is that, you know, we long time it seems like we've been afraid of sending our kids to school or to you know, by on foot or by bike. But tech is really helping with that. We already see that people are taking Uber and Lyft and they're not scared. It's essentially getting in the car with a stranger, just like hitchhiking was. But now at least you know that with GPS, even if the worst possible thing happens to you, somebody's tracking it. So that part of it will be taken care of. So I think that gives us all, it reduces our fear of traveling in these sort of more scary ways that seem scarier than just driving ourselves as a default. Any questions? I've got one last little bit here, and I think we're way over though, aren't we? Are we over? Well then why don't I just run through my last little spiel, which is sort of taking examples from other industries that haven't been successful, which I consider public transportation is not successful because not enough people take it or know about it or want to take it or have a nice view of it. How did they get from a spot that was sort of a business no win to a point where they were very successful? And I think there are five lessons that I'll go through real quick from other industries that we can use to try to get public transportation up to snuff. One thing that you can do is to settle in for the long haul. This is not something that public transportation is going to become awesome and incredible overnight. It takes work, and like at Mobility Lab, we don't talk in our blogs about we need big funding for public transportation for a huge project. We need more transit. We need more trains. No, we go in little bits and pieces. These little bits and pieces, like the IOB bus stop story, you know. These little chunks, and then we try to target them out to people who might be able to do something about it and spread the word that way. Nobody used to think that the second, you know, even the most right-wing gun lovers in the country, it wasn't that long ago that they weren't calling for every individual in the U.S. to have guns. That wasn't what even was on anybody's mind. But over time before that, the NRA had started, you know, going into different states and trying to influence how do we influence gun laws in states. They went state to state to state, and eventually there was enough groundswell on, you know, let's make guns more popular, essentially, let's sell more guns, that about a decade ago the Supreme Court said, okay, it's not, the Second Amendment isn't actually saying that this is, you know, it's a state militia can have guns. They reinterpret it as individuals can have guns. And so that's where we're at today. And, you know, I'm not making any value judgments on whether I like the NRA or I don't like the NRA or guns. I'm just saying that they were really smart about the way they tic-tac and strategically, you know, checked off places and got people to, you know, to put political pressure on. They had scorecards on legislators and how gun friendly they were, which I think is a great idea for other areas like transportation. We should have scorecards calling out the legislators who are really bad for public transportation and transit, the ones who are really good for it. I think that would be effective over time. The same-sex marriage advocates use this exact same tactic of let's go state to state, let's have a long tail campaign. Another example is addressing the disconnect. McDonald's and the fast food industry as a whole. You know, the country was getting more obese over time and sales were suffering. And so McDonald's came out and said, let's try healthy options on our menu. And it's not really working for McDonald's. Because we've trained ourselves over a long time that if we're going to go to McDonald's, we're going to McDonald's to get a Big Mac, damn it. We're not going to get, you know, what they claim is probably some sort of healthy smoothie or like the best salad in the world. We're going because we want to get, you know, nice and deliciously disgusting, if you will. It's really good going down, but, you know, it hurts us over the long term. It's the same with transportation. You know, we don't ever start to think, okay, we got to get to point B. We don't think, you know, the first thing in our mind is, how am I going to get there safely? First thing you think of is, how am I going to get there as fast as I can? So I think that's the disconnect with public transportation. Again, back to the, so focused on safety messages and so focused on, you know, it's okay to ride us. We're defensive. You should ride us. You can tell we don't think you should ride us, but you should ride us. So let's address that disconnect and start having more positive messages is essentially what it is. I think that made sense. I'm not sure if that came out exactly the way I meant to say it, but the third thing is target our audiences. Netflix is brilliant at this. The people who are running Netflix love TV. And they said, you know, that we grew up with network programming, but at the same time, we're never going to succeed if we don't take some of their audience away from them. So they did a survey and they found that 74% of viewers said they like to binge watch. But most of them didn't stick around after the pilot on networks. The network pilots, people would watch one and then they'd go away. So with the percentage of binge watch candidates and the percentage who left real quick, they decided to just start putting full seasons of TV shows up at once. So that you could hook them in after, you know, you've been there for 4 hours and now you're hooked by the fourth episode or whatever. And also when they're debuting new shows, they create 7 different trailers. Depending on what kind of person you are is the trailer that you're going to see. So they're trying to hook 7 different personality types with each show. I think Austin is a good example of targeting its audience. You know, Uber and Lyft just left recently Austin because Austin said, we're weird and we're not sure we want this corporate entity, you know, taking our people around. And they said, maybe you'll be weird enough, I guess, if you will let us fingerprint you. Any new drivers working for Uber and Lyft, you'd have to be fingerprinted. Uber and Lyft disagreed and refused to do that. But within weeks, a whole bunch of other organizations popped up that were offering, you know, tech-enabled ride sharing or ride hailing, I guess you would say. So they knew their audience. They knew that, you know, Uber and Lyft wouldn't work for them. And Austin, much like other places, should take Austin's hint also as well, that like really focus on your placemaking. I'm a big advocate of, you know, really discover who you are as a city and incorporate that into your transit, or meaning, you know, you might have to get folklorists or songwriters or storytellers to tell stories, to write stories, to sing in your subways or write songs about your transit systems. That all goes into targeting your audience as well, really becoming a destination and not just being there. The other thing, you know, I said it was a long-term campaign, but another lesson is that we can change real quickly. And this is, you know, pot used to be hippie outlaws. Now it's for kale chip eating soccer moms. Dixie's a company that has excelled at this. They sell snacks with sea salt and pepita, and I don't even know what pepita is, but it sounds pretty good. I just say if transit sold pot right now, we'd still be selling Bob Marley tie-dye t-shirts, and we need to be selling pepita, sea salt, chocolate, pod brownies, I guess. But they did it quickly. This was like less than 10 years ago that the pod industry was like still just enemy number whatever of the state. But now it's being embraced by whole different kinds of audiences. And last, again, back to the just be creative part, Dollar Shave Club. If you haven't seen the videos that Dollar Shave Club puts together, they're so hilarious. You should go watch one later today. They're like a minute. This guy's really funny. He's the CEO of it. And they just had this viral video campaign on YouTube. And they were nobody. They were the Dollar Shave Club. It's exactly what it sounds like. You can get razors that are pretty high quality that are a lot less than all the other razor conglomerates sell their razors for. Unilever, which is one of the biggest food grocery stores and food product companies, I guess, in the world, just bought them, mainly because I think they wanted the data that they have about men, but also because people have just built this huge brand loyalty to Dollar Shave Club, and they're not going away, they're not going anywhere. Any company or industry can have this success with this kind of creative mindset. So. Hopefully I didn't go over too long, and now we can talk about what you think about some of these ideas for a few minutes. Courtney, do we need to wrap up?
Maybe, 5 minutes?
Yeah.
So maybe a question or two, and then we've got to get through the next.
Over here.
There was something just recently on Facebook where cities with biking are starting to change the laws to allow rolling stops and even going through red lights for bikers to increase their safety on that. What's your thought about this whole intermodal issue and how we really begin to think about how that becomes much more in our daily thinking rather than just trying to solve specific problems?
Yeah, it's for years and years it's been this struggle of it's a war on cars or it's a war on bikes, and I think all of that is very wrong-headed way to think about, you know, improving. We're all people out there. We're all people going to our jobs, and we need to be treated equally. And I think it goes back to just, you know, if people have the experience on all kinds of different modes that they might understand a little better the perspective of the bicyclist. Almost everybody has a perspective of a driver. They know what that's like. What bicyclists really have their downfall is that a lot of people don't understand that, because most people quit bicycling, you know, by the time they're going to high school, and it's no longer cool at that point, and then they haven't done it for a long time. But in D.C., it's really great. I mean, people over the past 10 years, for sure, I bike from Maryland all the way through D.C. into Virginia every day on my commute. And the difference, just anecdotally, in the past 10 years is incredible. Not only are there bike lanes, about 90% of my ride is bike lanes, but they're not protected bike lanes for the most part, so they're almost useless. The real key is to have protected bike lanes where you can't get hit by car doors opening and cars.
So we're in a real transition phase as we change from an auto-centric to a multimodal.
Yeah.
And the messages out there seems to be picking at individual things rather than thinking about the issue holistically, and how you can begin a campaign that really talks about that aspect of it. And we know it's going to be hard for a while until the infrastructure can be put into place.
Yeah, and luckily the infrastructure with protected bike lanes is not all that, is relatively inexpensive. Compare that to a mile of road or something. There are places like Market Street in San Francisco that have done a pretty good job of building protected bike lanes on just a major, massive, essentially highway that protects the bicyclists and has good stoplight flow and things like that. But the difference of the past 10 years in D.C. is tremendous. It's amazingly safe compared to what it used to be. I used to almost get run off the road every day. Now I only almost get run off the road once a week or two. So I'd say, you know.
Is that because the investment's been made in alternative?
I think it's mostly because people understand that there are going to be bikes out here. I have to drive a little differently. I have to look behind me when I'm making a right turn into a bike lane, especially. I think it's just a mindset, and I think the education aspect needs to continue for drivers every bit as much as for, you know, bicyclists to behave and for pedestrians to behave and everything.
Did you see a change in the red light camera enforcement?
A change
in driver behavior towards,
where those red light cameras are, everybody knows where, especially with Waze and Google Maps. Now you see the red light camera coming up, or you can literally see it on the side of the road, and so you slow down.
Because I would argue that there's also a tendency now, just in terms of the cyclists and cars understanding that there are cyclists on the road, that drivers are paying more attention to their phones rather than the road.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And the only people I ever get almost hit by are people texting and not looking at the road.
But I think statistically you mentioned earlier that bicycle deaths have gone up, and this is not because there's a reason for that. It's not because more drivers understand that there's cyclists on the road. There's that other piece as well.
I think there's that. And traffic calming does help, which is, you know, red light cameras and speeding cameras. And just, you know, it's something like 90% of the people die, if pedestrians and bicyclists die, if they're hit by a car that's going 20 miles an hour over. But like 80 or 90% survive if they get hit by that same car going 20 miles or under. So 20 miles an hour is a real threshold that communities should embrace. And speed limits have gotten lower in Washington, D.C. in a lot of spots, along with the traffic calming and red light cameras and things like that. So I think that's part of an awareness campaign that's even bigger than a lot of the stuff that I'm talking about here, that, you know, the city has to get, not just communities who can put down renegade sort of pop-up bike lanes and stuff like that. I saw a hand here.
Are there It seems like most of these strategies are urban in nature, and it's and I was looking how the video is projecting out 10 to 20 years, but in 10 to 20 years, won't those cars be about one quarter of the size and be almost immune from congestion due to being completely networked together? Because if one person needs to get to work with their briefcase, why take a car that's four times the size they need to be?
Mm-hmm.
If the ownership paradigm is shifting to corporate ownership of cars rather than individual ownership of cars, will just make smaller cars.
That would be great. That would be wonderful. A lot of people argue about that timeline, as you probably know. Is it 20 years? Is it 60 years? Is it next year?
Yeah, that's the problem. We're rolling it out here, but they still have to have two people instead of one driver to shepherd the autonomous cars.
Absolutely. And I mean, it is the kind of thing that is probably going to work in the city first, and in rural areas, it's really difficult to get out of the car. I mean, think about traveling around Phoenix. You have to have a car. Whereas you don't have to have a car in a lot of other places in the city, in cities that are dense. But this kind of stuff, education, no matter what it is, can happen no matter where it is. Because I grew up in Edwardsville, Illinois, which is about 30,000 population outside of St. Louis. And they have amazing bicycle paths. Amazing. They go to every corner of town. They go to Chicago and Kansas City and, you know, onwards to, I think, Indianapolis. They can connect you everywhere within the city. Yet nobody takes them. When I'm out there and I visit and I ride those bike paths that are beautiful, I only see families and, you know, weekend warriors in their spandex. I don't see people just taking utilitarian bike trips to the grocery store or to work or to go out for dinner at night. So that kind of mindset, it's a real loss. And it's because there's no education about, look, you can use bike trails, bike paths, paved bike paths, and you'll get there just as fast to the other side of town, and you don't have to deal with traffic, because traffic's even getting pretty bad there in a 30,000 little suburb.
Do you think people are embarrassed to be seen walking or taking the bus?
Absolutely.
And how do you change that?
We have cool campaigns. We have, you know, make these things cool, make them likable, make them enticing, make our ads inspiring, and let's, you know.
Is Edwardsville,
It is in Southern Illinois, right outside St. Louis. All right. Thank you all so much for giving us so much of your time today.